Let's go to South Windsor, Connecticut, where Dr. Jay Sutay, the hardest working pediatrician in comedy, is standing by. Hello, sir.
How you doing, David Feldman?
Much better now that you're on the line, sir. So you deal with kids all year round, and now you have a week off?
I am off for two glorious weeks. I go back January 3rd. I have seen my last ear infection. I have cured my last asthmatic. I have treated my last depressed teenager of 2018, and I am ready for the fucking calendar to roll over, baby.
What do you tell your kids about General Mattis resigning and Donald Trump declaring victory over ISIS and the unraveling of our democracy? What do you tell a kid?
I think it's great that my daughters have very little knowledge about government politics and things like that. They probably couldn't even tell you how many houses there are in Congress. So I think, much like a lot of people out there, it's best just to stick your head in the sand and make and wait for it to go away.
Wait for it to go away.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My kids, they voted only because I forced them to register this year and just vote straight down the Democrats. And they did that for me because they love their father. But yeah, in terms of them even having a bit of interest in what is going on in the White House, it's absolutely absent. I mean, it's I look at my daughter who is back home living with me. I look at the queue on our cable, and I got shit in there like Kardashians and Real Housewives of this place and that place and Teen Mom. I mean, they're just filling their heads with idiocy.
Listeners to my show disagree with you. They think you have to act globally, and I agree. But there is something to be said for doing what you do, which is acting granularly. Being a pediatrician, you deal with enough every day. You make the world better, so you're entitled to not watch the TV and read the New York Times and
maybe
and get a vacation from it. But it does end up biting you in the ass. If you don't pay attention, if you bury your head in the sand, your ass is prone to get bitten.
Right. And I learned a lot by listening to your podcast. I'm a regular listener as well. And I've learned so much in this last midterm election cycle. And I have to thank you for that.
Well, doctor.
I thought that the fellow who did the impassioned plea for Medicare for all or single payer, that was a heck of a episode. I could not have punctuated that any better. He did a great job.
Well, we had Thomas Morris on last week. He's the author of
The Unusual Things.
The British
I listened
guy.
To that. Yeah, I listened to that.
In case you missed it, last week we had Thomas Morris on. He wrote a book called The Mystery of the Exploding Teeth and Other Curiosities from the History of Medicine. It's a fun book. He scoured medical journals that go back 300 years, and there's stories of a guy who threw up his twin brother. And
there you go.
Yeah, all these medical anomalies.
And a lot of things being put into orifices.
Yes.
A lot of that stuff. You know what's interesting is kids that I take care of will stick things up their nose and in their ears. Mm-hmm. But I have never had a kid come in with something shoved up his ass in 26 years. I mean, it's not even on the horizon for the kids aren't even thinking it in my age group. I've not even a teenager has come in with something shoved up his ass. I mean, that is a completely adult problem, ladies and gentlemen.
Especially your head up your ass. A lot of Americans are doing that these days. Do they
best explanation is not enough Indians.
Not enough Indians.
If we still had Indians threatening us, we wouldn't have time to shove shit up our ass. We'd have to be on high alert. There's not enough Indians.
There are plenty of Indians in the medical profession. It's a different type.
Yeah.
When you were in medical school,
yes,
did they teach you the history or was it forward thinking? This is how you cure it. Don't look back. It doesn't matter how we used to do things. Is there any import to savoring the past and looking at how far we've come?
Yeah, I think we did have early on in medical school a medical history type course because this area, Hartford Hospital, is one of the first places where they used anesthesia for patients and stuff. So there's a lot of rich medical history in and around Hartford. So, that was taught to us. It wasn't we didn't spend a month on it, but we had, you know, afternoon lectures that covered that stuff. And but most of it was, you know, I liked going to medical school because every class I took was science. So it was great.
We were talking when we were working up in Collinsville. I met one of the guys you went to medical school with.
Yeah, Leo. He's terrific. He and I, we actually went through our residency together.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't want to talk about what we talked about because it's not easy being a pediatrician. You deserve as much happiness as you possibly can this week because I couldn't do what you do. The difference between lice and dandruff.
Okay. Lice crawl, dandruff doesn't.
Have you ever told somebody they had lice when it turned out to be
bad? I have seen parents and children with live lice crawling on their foreheads.
If you're a member of PETA,
yeah,
I guess that's okay.
Well, not only do you have to and want to kill the lice, you have to comb out the hair and get all the nits out of the hair right down at the hair shaft. There's special combs you need to use pretty, you know, toxic medicine in the shampoo you have to use. And then you really have to treat everyone in the house. Then you got to throw all the laundry, wash it on hot. If there's any things you can't wash, you got to throw them in a dark plastic bag and throw it in the basement for a week because they can't live off the human body. And then 2 weeks later, you got to do the shampoo again. But if you leave even one little nit in there, if you don't get that last nit on a hair shaft and you miss it, infestation comes right back.
So when I find hats on the streets of New York.
Yeah. Yep. Yep.
Don't
worry. If it's a cold day and your ears are freezing, you know, you might want to put a shower cap on and then the cap.
Does the cold weather kill the lice? And what is the difference between a nit and a lice?
Nit is the egg. That's the little white egg that attaches to the hair shaft that the lice lay. And the lice are the live bugs that crawl around that you could actually see. They're quick, though. They're quick. I mean, I've seen one in an eyebrow.
When you say quick, like funny?
Big, no, quick, know, sharp like on the... No, not like you. Not like you.
They're just quick, hard to get rid of.
Yeah, and they're different than the pubic infestation. That's a different kind of lice altogether.
Go on.
No, I'm just saying that just lice on the hair is usually different than lice down there, but it's the same treatment. You got to... And there's also, I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think I read recently that one of the antibiotics we use, if you take it by mouth, it will... I can't remember if it's lice or scabies, though. But
okay.
Same principle.
Now, the eggs, if it's on your head, it would be a nit. If it's pubic, it would be a nut.
There you go.
I don't know.
And if you have more than two.
You got one more than Hitler had.
And can I praise Jackie the Joke Man, too? His segments are hilarious. I laugh the whole time after he's done. Can't remember a goddamn joke he said.
I know.
So fast. One is funnier than the next.
I know. And I write them down. And I can't tell them the way he does.
And you have a great laugh, man. That segment, I laugh because you're laughing so goddamn hard.
Yeah, I have to put Jackie on at the end because it's the end. There's no point. Right.
Yeah, it's just out of control, and everything that comes out of his mouth is hilarious.
Today is Tuesday, so the one Friday,
I'm on Guillermo now. I haven't gotten a Jackie yet.
Okay, so the one that we posted Friday, I actually thought of holding off till Christmas and just running it for Christmas.
It's a Christmas present. Yeah,
but he was out of control. I mean, there were some jokes where I thought, you know... These are too funny. And people say to me, anyway, bowel obstructions.
They're jokes. The only reason that they're being told is they're jokes. People are not when did we start taking jokes seriously?
Well, it's all context and they're wrong. What is the intent? If the intent is to hurt you, any joke is bad. He gets the whole rainbow coalition. He's going after everybody.
Yeah, and he's just poking fun at groups, which is what drew me to comedy in the first place. We have to point out our differences. Otherwise, you know, who would know?
And it's stupid.
His jokes are harmless, funny, silly jokes that I probably heard a lot of jokes in that vein when I was 8 or 9 years old, for goodness sake.
Yeah. Bowel obstructions. What is a benign bowel obstruction? I often hear about this. What is the difference between a bowel obstruction and constipation?
All right. Well, constipation is kind of a bowel obstruction. I mean, a bowel obstruction can be anything that gets stuck in your intestines and doesn't let stuff get through. And, you know, we've seen at least a couple of times in my office, the kids who twirl their hair and chew on their hair. I've had two kids that have had to have surgery to remove a big ball of hair that blocked their intestines.
How do you know you weren't accidentally treating a cat?
The cats do that too. That's a problem with them. But most humans don't eat their hair.
I'm imitating a cat throwing up.
With a hairball? Sounds like you're talking in click.
Yeah. Yeah. So.
But yeah, and other things, kids can be born with, you know, a twist in their intestine or a narrowing and something called volvulus or malrotation where it twists and things can't get through because structurally there's a twist in it. Other kids can have something on the outside pressing on the intestines causing a bowel obstruction. And, you know, it's just things can't get past it. So you have nothing to do except vomit. People who've had surgery, previous abdominal surgery, can have adhesions that can pinch the bowel so that things can't get through. So anybody who's ever had, you know, abdominal surgery that has, you know, vomiting, abdominal pain, you know, you can't treat that as if it's a stomach bug because it's always a possibility that they developed an obstruction. So, you know, we usually have those kids x-rayed.
Breasts get infected?
Sure, all the time if you're breastfeeding, because those little baby lips and tongues, they beat the shit out of those nipples.
But so it's the nipples that get infected, but not
the... Well, what happens is yeast or skin bacteria gets into the little fissures and areas that are open on the nipple because the baby is, wearing it out, you know, almost to a sense where there can be little breaks in the skin there. So then baby mouth bacteria, skin bacteria, yeast can get into the milk ducts and cause mastitis, which then is... it's an infection not just of the nipple, but then it's spread into the breast through the milk ducts. And that can be very painful, very serious. Usually have to get started on antibiotics. And in order to make it go away quicker, they usually recommend that, you know, moms pump their breast milk, not use it for the baby, but not stop because it takes longer. You know, if the milk backs up, it takes longer for the infection to go away. So it can be quite painful to have to pump an infected breast, I would imagine.
Do you see kids suffering from depression? Really?
I see a lot of kids suffer from sadness that gets interpreted as depression because kids get sad. You know, they can be sad for months, but, you know, if they're going to school, they're getting out of bed, they're eating regular, not losing weight, you know, it's sadness. It's not depression. I mean, kids who have true depression, I see that too. They're kids who, you know, can't get out of bed in the morning. You know, you try to make contracts with the school to, you know, try to get them in there, but they literally don't have the energy to get out of bed. They don't eat. They don't remember to eat. You know, it can be as serious as it is, you know, when an adult has a major depression. So there's both, and you really have to, you know, put on your thinking cap to figure out sometimes which one is which. But, you know, I have a number of kids who, you know, are either anxious or depressed to the point where, you know, they miss 45 days of school a year.
Wow. How do parents react when you say to them, you know, your kid's kind of a bummer?
Not well. Trust me, they already
do
know.
Do they know?
They do, because, you know, they're exhausted every morning trying to drag them out of bed, get the kid to go to school. And, you know, my daughter had a lot of anxiety when she was kindergarten through seventh grade. And, you know, after a weekend home, getting her out of bed and off to school on a Monday morning was sometimes tough. I mean, I threw her in the car a couple times in her pajamas and said, the school's 5 minutes away. You better get dressed because whatever you have on when we get there, you're wearing in.
Right, right. You know, I was watching this comic. His name is Patel. He was kicked off the stage of Columbia for telling
a
joke.
Yeah, I know that story, yeah.
Judging by the joke, they were wrong.
I think I heard the joke before, but still, they took it. They interpreted it wrong, and it wasn't really making fun of anybody. It was a joke where he was like saying, you know, he was commiserating, more or less.
So we do have kids who are afraid to go to school, though. And
oh, yeah, one fire drill in September, half the first grade won't be there.
What do you mean?
Anxiety after a fire drill. That's why I say we should add Celexa to the Frosted Flakes. You never know when you're going to have a fire drill.
There's nothing wrong with fighting stridently for safe spaces. There are consequences to terror.
Of going to school. That's right.
Yeah.
I didn't have that excuse in the 1970s when I was pulling the same bullshit, but still.
Right. I mean, if there is a bully, he said, there are bullies, and they say, you know what? I'm going to beat you up next time I see you, which is a great thing to say to somebody when they're young because it creates terror.
Yeah. And then we become comedians.
And we become comedians, yeah. So a lot of flu going around. Corey Bretschneider couldn't do the show this week. He's got the flu.
Did Corey get the vaccine?
He's an anti-vaxxer. You didn't know about that?
Yeah, I saw something the other day. It was funny. Guys,
by the way, hang on for one second. Hang on. Okay. Corey Bretschneider is not an anti-vaxxer.
But you made me think of this this little joke someone said. He goes, I'm only going to knock up anti-vaxxers. At least I don't have to pay child support.
Who said that?
I don't know. I read it somewhere. It's not mine. It was hilarious.
That's funny. We got to be careful quoting jokes anonymously. So a lot of people throwing up. What's the best thing to eat after food poisoning, after you got sick to your stomach? Easing back into your digestive system.
Well, the brat diet, bananas, rice, applesauce, and toast, if you remember that. And anything that is simple sugars and fluid. So Gatorade, Kool-Aid, ginger ale. You don't need to get any fancy electrolyte stuff, but you just want to, you don't want to only take care of hydration. You want to make sure it's got some sugar in it because you could get hypoglycemic if you're vomiting and not able to eat anything. But you got to go slow. You got to be able to tolerate, sips of clear liquids without puking for at least, 5 or 6 hours before you try food. And then you start with the, a little brat diet, a little bit of toast, no butter, plain pasta works too. And then if you don't yak that up, that's the same diet that you're going to stick with when the shits come over the next 2 days. That's the typical stomach bug, like 8 to 12 hours of puking and then diarrhea for 2 days.
It's puking and then diarrhea.
Always.
Hmm. And is it ever reversed?
Where you shit out of your mouth?
Do people ever get the shits first and then puke?
Usually not, because when they ingest the virus, but usually you get the virus off of touching a surface, you touch your mouth. Well, the first line of defense is it gets to the stomach and tries to multiply. The stomach tries to reject it, but everything doesn't get out of there, so it passes through and it causes, inflammation of your intestines, and that's why you get the runs afterwards. So it usually follows, the typical stomach virus that, not rotavirus. Rotavirus, you lose it from both ends at the same time, so you can get dehydrated pretty quickly, but we've been vaccinating kids against that for probably the last 10 years or
What's
so.
What's it called?
Rotavirus.
Should be called the Roto-Rooter virus.
Well, it does, and you can dehydrate pretty quick if you're losing it from both ends. And hospital emergency room visits for dehydration have dropped so much because of that vaccine, you wouldn't believe it. I mean, every day we'd have a kid in the ER getting fluids for a stomach bug or something, and now we just doesn't happen nearly as much as it used to. It's all teenage depression now.
Yeah,
I'll tell you.
Well, we've raised a generation of parents with the wrong values. So it's only,
you're right.
So what follows next are children who are brought up and instilled with the wrong ideas. Shop,
right.
Buy, go to the mall.
Yeah.
We have an entire generation of adults now who think that anything that's advertised is true. They're not being misled through advertising.
Right.
It's pretty scary stuff, what's happening to this country.
Nobody learns how to be discerning in the information that they take in. They take it in if they read it or they heard it. It's got to be true, but nobody does the due diligence of thinking it through or look at something and say, that doesn't sound right. Nobody questions anything like that anymore.
It's why that comic got kicked off stage at Columbia, which is a pretty good school.
Right.
Those kids kicked that guy off the stage, shut off his mic, because he said black and gay.
Right, right.
And this is
Columbia, a good chance ever getting a good comic back to Columbia.
This is a generation, I hate to be a scold, but it's a generation that's learned to think in sound bites, in headlines, and not going beneath. And these Columbia kids hear some buzzwords that are edgy, and they figure, well, if this guy's saying gay and black, it must be homophobic and racist.
And it was neither.
It was neither.
That's the problem when you just listen to little sound bites all day. You don't listen to context. And you can't. It's if you're not going to be able to follow the logic of a joke from start to finish, and you're going to get hung up on singular words inside of that joke. Why are you at a comedy show? And how the fuck did you get into Columbia?
Yeah.
If you're not, you know, not able to distinguish between the two, it doesn't make any sense.
Well,
so even the best and the brightest are not what we're in need of either.
Well, they're not the best and the brightest. The people who get into these Ivy League schools don't have critical thinking.
They don't.
They're absorbed into the quote unquote meritocracy and do what they're told. That's how you get into those schools. You're able to follow instructions. How do you like that?
It's too much for me, David. I'm on vacation, for All God's right. sake.
Dr. J. Sutay is the hardest working pediatrician in comedy. Go see this man. He is really funny. He's also not a bad comic either.
Yeah.
Stay on the line for 1 second, doctor.
Sure. Thanks, David.
That was great.